Nice to meet you, Alex, from RedStone. Let's dive into the interview. I'm just going to ask you some questions about RedStone, about your project, and how you guys integrated Streamr. Yeah, let's just dive right into it. So could you tell me a little bit about RedStone and the project you are working on at the moment?
Sure. So nice to meet you, Nico. We are building so-called new generation of oracles, which will be way more scalable comparing to other oracle solutions. And the main difference, like the key difference between RedStone and other oracles, is that we don't force our data providers to put data on chain directly. Instead, we allow them to sign data using their private keys and broadcast the data so that end users of DApps can just like receive the data from this broadcasting layer, which is actually powered by Streamr, attached to their transaction as a separate argument or as just like a postfix in the transaction call data. And then the smart contracts, like on chain, can verify the integrity of the data using like this cryptography, using signer recovery. And they also can like compare if the timestamp is relevant, if it's not too old. And if yes, the data can be forwarded to the target smart contract with the logic of the DApp. So this is the main difference, that thanks to this approach, where data providers don't need to put data on chain directly, they don't need to pay gas costs for putting the data on chain. Thus, they can, like, it's really cheap for them to provide data. And they can update data way more frequently. They also can just provide much more different types of data. I like the analogy of the computer. Like, the blockchain is something like a computer, because it is a computer, it's a decentralized computer. But this computer is isolated. It's not connected to the internet. It's not connected to the data from the real world. And what oracles do, they connect this computer to the internet, like in one direction, usually, because they only provide data to this computer. What RedStone does is we improve the connection to the internet.
Okay, so you kind of make it cheaper, right?
Yeah, way cheaper.
Great, that's awesome. Cool. Could you just go a little bit deeper in how you are utilizing Streamr to build this kind of how to make it cheaper, or like how you utilize the protocol or the network rather to do this?
Mm-hmm. Sure. So each data provider oracle node that we have has the obligation of putting data like to some specified stream in Streamr, and then we have so-called cache nodes, which are actually also Streamr nodes, and they just listen to the streams from our oracle nodes, and they save the data. And then users can just like fetch data from this cache node. And what's interesting is that everyone can launch this type of cache node, because like we have the public streams. You just start listening. Like, if you're a technical user, you can just launch your own cache node, start listening to the Streamr data, and use it in your, like, how you want. And this is where decentralization comes from. So this is as simple as this.
That sounds great, Alex. That sounds very interesting. How did you hear from Streamr the first time, or like how did you guys meet Matthew, for example, the first time? Or like, why are you using Streamr?
This is a great question. I was just doing research. I was trying to find the good solution for us, because initially we didn't have this decentralized broadcasting layer. We just had the cache nodes received the data from Oracle nodes directly, which is not really sustainable, because it's not decentralized. Not everyone can launch their own cache node this way, because each Oracle node needs to know this, like each cache node, and they would need to put data, like somehow access the actual list. So it was just like not perfect. And I was trying to find the good solution. I was exploring some different ones, actually, and Streamr just was the most convenient, and like it was just the perfect match, the perfect fit for us, because it worked, and it worked quite easily. Like it was really easy to implement, to integrate. Like I was able to check if it works in a few minutes just by running the code from the web page. It worked, and I decided like, okay, probably we should go here. Then I like joined your Discord, somehow connected with Matthew. Oh, maybe I also applied for a grant or something. So just like I was doing a research and found Streamr, and it was great. Also, we were also considering Swarm Network, or like I'm not sure if I remember correctly. Yeah, probably it's Swarm. It's called Swarm, ETH Swarm. It's quite an old project, but it was way more difficult to integrate with them.
What was more difficult about them than us, if you remember?
Yeah, like just to check if it works, you were forced to launch your own node, and this launching the node was not easy. You would need to have some different kinds of tokens, and this is the first thing. The second thing, which probably helped a lot, is that Streamr, like we can use Streamr for free, so we can just like try if it works, and then if we would like to improve the topology or like improve the service, and which we will probably do, as reliability is also very important for oracles. So yeah, this is just convenient when you can try for free, and then if you like the service, you can start paying for it, which made a lot of sense for us.
Yeah, that sounds good. You kind of already answered my question. Why do you prefer Streamr over some Web2 solutions? But I'm just gonna ask you this again and hope that you come up with a different answer. But we'll see.
Yeah, sure. So the main reason is the decentralization. If we build something for the Web3 space, we would like to make it as open as possible. And having our own cash nodes is not the decentralized way.
Fair enough. Yes. Great. Awesome. Okay. And what do you like most about Streamr Network?
That it works.
That's a good reason.
Yeah. And as I've said, it's just very easy to integrate. It's very easy. It's being created with thoughts about and developers who will use it, and mm-hmm. like I can see it because I'm a developer and like I used it. It was quite simple. There's some convenience and like just that it works. These are the main reasons.
You said it's easy. Would you say it's easy enough that you could integrated easily into a hackathon project, for example?
Oh yeah, for sure. Yeah. I think without any problems, it would be very easy. Like as I said, the first time I checked the Streamr, it like was 5 minutes or 10 minutes, and it worked. So yeah, definitely it can be integrated during the hackathon.
That's great to hear. Awesome. What's the most important task that you need to perform with Streamr? I guess you already kind of said it, but let's just go over it again. And what's like the most important task? If everything else you can just kind of scrap, but what's the most important task? Is it the decentralization, or is it what do you think?
I think this implementation of the cache nodes that listen to the Streamr was one of the most important tasks. Oh, we actually have some plans of building new things based on Streamr, probably with some interesting hacks. I will let you know like soon about the plans. The only problem that I can see with Streamr is that sometimes it takes some time to initiate, like to connect to peers, so for end users, like if our Oracle nodes would provide data every minute, and then the initialization of the Streamr client would take like 2 minutes, which can take 2 minutes. So the end user would need to wait 3 minutes if they would like to not use cache node, because we also thought about this approach. We actually have implemented this approach, that user could just fetch data from Streamr directly from their browser. They could just like initialize the Streamr clients inside their browser and fetch the data from Streamr, but it wasn't really sustainable because of this waiting time.
Mm.
Yeah, but we have some ideas how we can like improve this part as well.
That's actually great. Sorry for interrupting you there, but that's kind of connecting to my next question, which is if you ran into anything where you were like, oh, we need to build a workaround for or with Streamr to kind of face that challenge.
Yeah, like the main... Yeah, the main thing that we actually thought about, like what can be implemented in Streamr to make our life more, like way easier, is the possibility of getting the latest value from like the stream, even if it wasn't published like right away, like now. If it was published like 30 seconds ago, we would like to, like without, if it's possible to get this value directly. But as far as I understood, it's not as easy as it looks, and that's why we've implemented this cache notes approach. This was kind of a workaround for us. Another thing is data persistence, like, but it's not a workaround, it's just like Streamr was designed to broadcast the data to, but we also need to keep the data somewhere persistently, and we use Arweave blockchain for this, and we have already implemented some type of solution which offloads the data from our cache nodes. Like some cache nodes can specify how they want to do this, and they offload the data from the Streamr to the Arweave, where the data can be accessed. Like they will be there permanently. That's how Arweave works. It's a blockchain designed to store large sets of data, and yeah, it's great for getting historical data, historical Oracle data, for example, or to just to keep the data providers accountable, so we can check what kind of data did they provide to Streamr. It also can be decentralized because multiple different cache nodes can put data to Arweave, and then we can come to some consensus of it. So yeah, the main workaround was to build the cache node. It was like our main, an important technical challenge, but also some kind of a workaround. Another workaround is, and yeah, I can probably tell a bit more about this. We think about like Streamr client is quite a big NPM module, so because you need to like spin up the whole node, and sometimes it's like just some front end developers don't like having so big and like so performance consuming modules on the front end side, and we thought about probably utilizing iframes somehow, for example, having a static web page, which would have this Streamr client, and like as a backup source, we would just inject this iframe with the Streamr client. Then the frontend code would not need to have this dependency, but the frontend still would be able to get the data from Streamr, but using this iframe. But only like, for example, if something crashes, if our cache nodes doesn't work, then when we can switch this backdoor with the iframe.
That's clever. That's very interesting. I would love to learn more about this, how you guys approach it. And was that something the Streamr team kind of taught you to do, or is that something you guys came up with? Or
no, actually, we came up into this like a few weeks ago, probably.
Wow, that's pretty
cool. Yeah. Another thing, and actually, like, I'm a bit sorry because I asked about this on the last Streamr call, if we can have some custom signers for the Streamr clients, and because we thought we would like to use AWS KMS, which is a like service for signing, like for keeping private keys safe, and just service for signing data. And yeah, and you guys helped us by implementing this kind of support. But unfortunately, we decided not to go with the AWS KMS because we just don't want to bind too closely with cloud providers, because also, again, from the decentralization reasons.
Yeah, that's fair enough. I mean, we're always happy to help, and if you decide against something in the end because it doesn't make sense, then that of course is up to you, and that makes, you know, it's a reason for that as well, right? But great, awesome, cool. I'm kind of out of question actually. So yeah, it was nice having you in the interview. And is there any last thing you kind of wanted to say about the RedStone Streamr partnership or synergy or anything you want to tell me?
Yeah, just maybe to repeat that I'm really excited about this partnership, and yeah, it's great to see how your project grows and develops, and like it's great to see how we can develop together. We are definitely waiting for this trackerless switch in the future, because yeah, as I said, reliability of our data is also very important for us. So yeah, it's just a great pleasure to work with you guys.
Awesome, man. Likewise, definitely. Looking forward to what you guys have in how RedStone's going to evolve and everything. Very excited.